very eminent speaker, Professor T. Padmanabhan, distinguished professor, IUCAA Pune. And I would like to call up on Dr. Gadkari to please come and introduce the speaker to us and also welcome them.
Very good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, friends and colleagues, distinguished invitees. Professor T. Padmanabhan, distinguished professor, Inter-University Center for Astronomy and Astrophysical Physics, Pune, an internationally acclaimed theoretical physicist. He has made important contribution to quantum cosmology, the statistical mechanics of gravitational systems, and gravitational clustering in the expanding universe. He has, to his credit, more than 270 publications that has attracted more than 13,000 citations. His contribution have made such a significant impact that he earned Padma Shri, Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award, and honor of becoming visiting professor at several prestigious universities, including Princeton University, California Institute of Technology, USA, and so on. He is also a recipient of the Third World Academy Science Prize in Physics. He has supervised several PhD work of students from different institutions. Besides, he is strongly committed to science popularization as well as public outreach programs and commands a worldwide following. Today, he will be dealing with gravity. Gravity, which is mysterious because despite being weakest of four fundamental interactions, it can compress massive stars into neutron. And in some cases, it can even compress them into a black hole. The subject of the topic is very, very topical in the light that recent confirmation of gravity waves by the laser interferometry, gravitational wave observatory, LIGO. Further, it is also important because India has taken up this challenge to set up similar facility. Indian astronomers like Aryabhatta, Bhaskaracharya, and in the West, Sir Isaac Newton, consider gravity to be a force that objects exert upon each other. Newton could describe this gravity through his mathematical formulation, but he didn't believe that space affected by these objects. Einstein did. He theorized that a mass can warp the space, bend it, push it, or pull it. To Einstein, gravity was just a natural outcome of a mass's existence in space. Gravitational lensing and changes in the orbit of Mercury showed that he has captured element of truth. By 1936, Hubble was convinced that universe is not static and at all it is moving even now and it is expanding. So some push is countering gravity's pull. Michael Turner called this push as dark energy. Now there are several questions in this field, and can we do away with dark energy or taking help from even thermodynamics? The answer to such questions warrant a help from authority like Professor Padmanabhan. And given the multifaceted and profound definitive contribution of Professor Padmanabhan in this field, which cover not only the research but also educational activities, we certainly are in a colloquium of special gravity. Now I will call upon Professor Padmanabhan to deliver his talk, and before that I would like to welcome with a bouquet Professor Padmanabhan, please. Professor also is accompanied by his wife, and I will request one of my colleagues, Dr. Shashwati Sen, to offer a bouquet.
I'm delighted to be here today. This is the third time I'm giving at Trombay Colloquium, and I would like to thank the organizers, in particular Dr. Gadkari and Dr. Pushpa Rao, who initiated it and also took a lot of pain to make my visit so smooth. Thank you very much. So the topic today, the first part of it would be rather easy. What did Einstein's gravity mean, and what has it achieved in the first 100 years? But what is really interesting is I'm going to talk to you about what is going to happen in the next 100 years, because that is in the best traditions of physics, that we should predict things rather than post-dict things. And this is my own perspective, but I'm sure 100 years down the line when somebody gives a Trombay colloquium, he will confirm this. So the starting point of this, the way gravity is understood today, is through Einstein's paradigm that is called the general theory of relativity. So the first part of the talk, I want to introduce you to general theory of relativity and all the good things general theory has done. And then in the second part, I will take a more subdued note and I will talk to you about the problems this theory is facing and how possibly in the next 100 years we will tackle them. So this is the overall structure of the talk. So let me begin by talking to you what general relativity is. The thing which strikes everyone when they see general relativity is the gorgeous elegance of that theory. This is probably the most beautiful of all existing theories. So many people have said this, and I have taken a particular quote which says that it represents probably the most beautiful of all existing physical theories. That certainly doesn't sound too profound or poetic. Why am I picking this quote? The reason I am picking this quote is the source. It occurs in something which at least some of you would know. There is a 10-volume work on theoretical physics by two very famous Russian physicists, Landau and Lifshitz. And this is from the volume 2 of that course. The landmark of these volumes is that they don't waste a single word. It is very terse, to the point, and there is no talking about humanity or who did what. And even they, when they come to general theory of relativity, they were forced to pause and put in this sentence, which has no physics content. And that is what general relativity does for you, and in some sense, this is the greatest prize general relativity has received. So why is it so beautiful? It is beautiful because Einstein took two very elementary principles, one called principle of equivalence and other the principles from special theory of relativity, and combined it, and from that came the fantastic conclusion that gravity is not a force, but it is represented by the curvature of the space-time. So this is what I want to make you appreciate, because it is important, even though it might sound a bit technical, it is very important, and I'm going to spend some time on that. So let us look at these two components. The first component is the concept of space-time, which combines space and time in special theory of relativity. So this is what you learn in your textbook, BSc level textbook. What is important for us is that special relativity told you that the motion affects the flow of time. Flow of time is measured by clocks. So if I have one clock on the table, and another clock which goes around and comes back to the table, the second clock will show smaller lapse of time compared to the clock which is at the table. So this is a key conclusion from special theory of relativity. And what is principle of equivalence? I said there are two ingredients here, principle of equivalence and special relativity. What we need from special relativity is essentially this fact. And let us look at principle of equivalence. Principle of equivalence is even simpler. There is supposed to have been this experiment Galileo has done. He never did that, but it's a good story. Galileo dropped two balls from the Leaning Tower of Pisa. Let us say a 5-kilogram ball and a 1-kilogram ball. And he found that both of them fall at the same time. One intuitively feels that heavier things has to fall faster. If you drop a hammer and a feather, obviously hammer will fall first and feather will fall later. This experiment was performed by David Scott. There's a beautiful YouTube video on this. They did it in vacuum, almost vacuum, on the surface of the moon. And he actually saw the feather and the hammer fall simultaneously together. It's nice to watch that video. So gravity acts and induces the same acceleration on all material media. That looks very simple. But what is so profound about it? What Einstein saw into this is a great vision. He said that, look here, suppose there is somebody who is sitting in a laboratory near Earth, a closed room, and doing something. Now you put that old lady in the cabin and let that cabin accelerate upwards with the same acceleration due to gravity as Earth. Now if you release two balls here, just let go, what will happen? There is no force acting on it. You are in interstellar space. So the balls will stay where they are. But the floor of the room will come and hit the balls. Now the floors of the rooms do not know whether it's a 5-kilogram ball or a 2-kilogram ball or a 10-kilogram ball. So it will hit it simultaneously. So this is the beauty of Einstein's concept. He took this fact that two balls fall at the same acceleration, turned it around into a principle, saying that what happens here is indistinguishable from what happens here. Once you have this principle, plus special relativity, it is very easy to show that gravity is a curved space-time. So I'm going to show you a few equations, but it is not very important, but it is so beautiful that I couldn't resist doing that. What he said was the following. Suppose you have a reference clock with a capital R, which shows a time interval dt, and you have another clock which moves a distance dx when this reference clock shows a time interval t with a subscript r. So you have a reference clock on the table. You have another clock which is moving. It moves a distance dx. Then the time shown by that moving clock would be given by this. This is what special relativity told you. Then he said, okay, take a rocket ship and put a clock in it. And the rocket ship is accelerating upwards. Then it is moving, so this formula applies. But we just now saw that what is happening in an accelerated ship upwards is the same as the same ship standing on Earth's gravity. So if the clock is slowing down here because it is moving, the clock has to slow down here. And in fact, you can write down exactly how much it will slow down. All you need is your plus two level formula. You know, v square equals u square plus 2gx, which you would have studied. And then this 2gx is nothing but the gravitational potential, twice the gravitational potential. So you go and substitute for this dx square there. If you substitute, you will get this formula, which can be written like this. So the time interval here, originally, when you looked at this formula, the time interval had nothing multiplying it. It was 1 and this was minus 1. Here what happens is that the time intervals get multiplied by something here and something here. So this is like when you write the distance between two points on the surface of a sphere, what do? You write things like d theta square plus sine square theta d phi square, etc. This is because the surface of the sphere is curved. This comes in because your space-time is curved. These quantities are called components of a metric tensor, and this is called a metric. And this metric represents a curved space-time. So this gravitational potential gets replaced by some quantities which is tensorial. Those are detailed mathematics. As I used to say, the genius part ends here. After that is pure technique, just the mathematical technique. And Einstein had the technique. So he could develop it and could show this. And this was pointed out by Pauli. I mean, Pauli is someone who likes to criticize everyone. But this is again something where Pauli has to be forced to say something good about somebody, that the fusion of this metric and gravitation must be considered the most beautiful achievement of GR. So this is all I wanted to tell you as the starting point of GR. But then, of course, somebody has to tell you what this is. I mean, how do you determine this gravitational potential? There is some equation which determines the gravitational potential. So you need some equation to determine this. And that is given by Einstein in a tensorial form. This is the engine which drives the gravity. So that is why it is given on an engine. Okay, and Einstein wrote down this equation. And you can solve this equation. And then you can predict everything which you want to know about gravity. So this is the rapid introduction to general theory of relativity. And the main point is that if there is a massive body somewhere, it curves the space around it. Think of this as some kind of a sponge, and you have put a ball here. And if I put another ball here, it will roll towards it. If I did not know that there is a sponge around, then I will say these two are attracting each other. So this is how curvature of the space-time make you feel as though two bodies are attracting each other by gravitational force. This is what Einstein said. And the curvature, how much it is curved, is defined by a radius of curvature. You draw some sphere here, it will have a radius. And that radius of curvature is inversely related to the density of matter or energy which is over there. The more the density, the more will be the curvature. That means the strongly curved it will be. Okay? And the radius of curvature will become, you know, smaller and smaller as the density becomes larger and larger. Remember this formula. This is an exact formula, and you can get all of Einstein's theory from this formula. So this we will come back to much later. So having said that, this is the basic starting point of the Einstein's theory. I want to compartmentalize GR and talk about various features of that during the first 100 years. So the first thing I want to talk about is the three new effects with Einstein's theory predicted. It's actually interesting in the sense that Einstein got something wrong in each one of them, okay? But it held together. So let me explain that to you. The first is what is known as the precession of the Mercury. So normally we learn that planets go around elliptical orbits with Sun in one focus. That is true. But what Einstein's theory does is that this orbit, you start like this, you go like this, you go like this, you are on an ellipse. But the next ellipse which you take is like this. So the ellipse itself precesses. It moves, the major axis of the ellipse was here, and the major axis of the ellipse is here. So the ellipse's axis itself precesses as time goes on. This was one of the predictions from Einstein's theory. And people knew at Einstein's time that the Mercury actually had an observed precession of about 574 arcseconds per century. This was known from astronomical observations. And theoretically, due to the perturbations by other planets, because if a planet is going around just Sun, it will be an ellipse. But it is not going influenced only by the Sun's gravitational force. In solar system, for example, there is Jupiter and Saturn, which are very large perturbers. And that accounted for nearly 532 of this 574. There is a slight difference. And Einstein's theory exactly predicted that. In fact, before Einstein hit on his final theory, he was trying out various kinds of equations. He was playing around with various ways of developing gravitational equation. And every time he will use this as a benchmark to get this. And he finally got the right result, actually using the wrong equations and an approximate metric. It just so happened that in the empty space, the equation he wrote down and the correct equations are identical. So he escaped. I mean, fortune favors the brave. And he was also using an approximate metric. It turned out that the corrections due to that is not relevant. Okay. So this was the first example where he actually goofed, but he got it right, got the correct result. And that was very important. Second is the bending of light. So here you have Sun during an eclipse, and the light ray from a star would have normally gone like this. Because of the Sun, it bends. It bends like this. So you will see the position, apparent position of the star here, while the actual position is here, and there is a shift. And you can measure that shift, because you look at the apparent position of the stars around the Sun in that eclipse, and then you compare it at the same place when the Sun is not there, and you can compare these two. This was done, and this is the famous telegram which Eddington, who ran the expedition to measure this, sent to Einstein, announcing this observation. And this made Einstein overnight famous. And there are sociologists and psychologists are still wondering how this happened. It had something to do with the post-war era, this, that, etc. But whatever it may be, Einstein became almost a household name after that. And newspapers were, these were not the days when newspaper hype was so much. I mean, you don't have internet and telephone calls and things like that. But he really became famous after the bending of light. Now, one of the most important applications of bending of light is first in testing and verifying alternate theories of gravity. Here is an example. It was considered a very small effect in those days, but today it is a huge effect. Okay? It's a huge effect because today in radio astronomy you work at milli arc second and micro arc second precision. So if you have few arc seconds of change, you are talking about factors of 100. So here is an example of what Einstein's theory predicts, normalized to some number 1. And these are the kind of observations which we have today, and most of the time error bars are so tiny that you have to just put it like this bracketing. Okay? And it used to be, of course, a very large effect. This is the kind of error bar which you had in optical band in those days. But with radio astronomy today, we have excellent verification of this theory. One of the consequences of this is an effect called gravitational lensing. That is, when the light bends, one of the things which bends light is a prism or a lens. So the lens also bends the light, and here also that happens. Because of the bending of light, the gravity acts like a lens, and it acts like a bad lens. It distorts the images. So this distortion contains huge amount of information. All these kinds of distortions contain huge amounts of information. And this is an extraordinarily thriving, flourishing field of research today called the gravitational lensing theory. Again, Einstein got it wrong. He did this in 1936 and concluded his paper by saying it is of very little value. Okay, and he just dismissed it. It took somebody called Zwicky. In a year's time, he wrote a paper. This is a beautiful paper. If you are on to theoretical physics, you should go and read this. It's a one-page paper in which he talked about where all this can be used. And this has kept astronomers busy in the next 70 years. So if you can write an one-page paper like that, then you can retire. I mean, he has predicted the entire field, what all can be done in that one page, after Einstein has said that it is of little value. And Zwicky had the courage to go and say that, no, it is very important and this all can be done. So this was the second important thing. And here is an example of gravitational lensing. If you look at this closely, you will see all these elongated things, and you can even see a ring-like structure. This comes about because these objects here are galaxies, very far away galaxies. And these objects you see here are nearby galaxies in a cluster. So there are light from a very far away galaxy which is coming through the gravitational field of a nearby cluster of galaxies. And the nearby cluster of galaxies distorts it. And that distortion is what you are seeing here in these ring-like shapes. This is again very important because when you calculate how much of distortion is there, you can measure how much of gravity is there. From that, you can measure how much of matter is there. And then you can compare it with the matter which you see here. And you find that these two things don't match. And you need a huge amount of dark matter, nearly 8 times more visible matter, in order to produce these. So this is one of the concrete evidences for the dark matter. So we will during the later part of the talk, we will say more about that. Okay. Now the third important one, which I'm sure all of you have heard now, is the gravitational waves. Einstein's theory predicted gravitational waves just like electromagnetic waves, and just like an oscillating charge produces the electromagnetic waves, a particular kind of configuration, this is called quadrupole, because in electromagnetic theory you would have learned dipole radiation, quadrupole radiation, etc. Dipole radiation cannot exist in gravitational wave because of momentum conservation, and the quadrupole is the lowest one, and when there is a quadrupole moment which is changing with time, that system will emit gravitational waves. So this is a major prediction of Einstein's theory, and it was verified not last year, long back, and a Nobel Prize was given to this in 1993 to two gentlemen, Hulse and Taylor. So the existence of gravitational waves being emitted by rotating binaries, that is two stars which are going around each other in a common orbit, was something which we knew in 1993. And in fact, it was so well established that a Nobel Prize has been given. So sometimes people feel that the gravity waves were detected recently, and you know, that sort of verified Einstein's theory, and it was a test of Einstein's theory. Well, as a test of the Einstein's theory and a verification of the gravitational wave emission by a system, it's a very old story, 1993. What was done recently is the actual laboratory detection of these waves. That is direct detection of the waves, rather than inferring it from the emission of something. So what did these people do? What these people do was to take two stars, which are going around each other, pulsars, and they measured the masses of them so accurately. And because it is emitting the gravitational radiation, general relativity predicts exactly how its period will change, that period of these pulsars will change. And that is denoted by P dot, and this is the theoretical prediction. The observation to the general relativistic prediction matches to this kind of accuracy. This was an extraordinarily beautiful experiment. And this is the result of that experiment. This is from a binary pulsar called 1913 plus 16. And this is the theory and observation. General relativity prediction is the straight line, and these are the observations. As you can see, you need from 1975 to 2005 to do this. Of course, they got the Nobel Prize a little earlier when all these data were there. But this is another beautiful way in which the theory can be used along with observations to test very strong field gravitational dynamics. Now we have so many other binary pulsars in which this is being done. And it tells you that the gravitational wave is a reality and it is emitted by this system. All that you need is excellent technology to detect it in your laboratory. And that is what happened recently. And this has been headline news all over the world. And it is very important for us to realize that there were around 37 researchers from 9 Indian institutions who were part of this LIGO science project. And they all got the credit for this. But this has been talked enough, so I won't go into that. Now let me come to, I talked about three new phenomena which Einstein's gravity predicted: bending of light, precession of mercury, and gravitational waves. Now let me go to two major areas which sort of bloomed after Einstein's gravity. It didn't exist before that. The first one is the concept of black holes in astrophysics. So in fact, there's a beautiful quotation here from Thomas Gold, who said in the first Texas astrophysics meeting that the general relativists suddenly found they are experts in an area which they hardly knew existed. Because general relativists are sort of esoteric mathematical people, and they don't worry about astrophysics. But in this meeting, they came together, and they realized that these black holes can have very important consequences in astrophysics. By and large, there are two kinds of black holes which people are looking at in the conventional astrophysical scenario. One is black holes with the masses between, say, 5 and 20 solar mass. And these are the stellar or superstellar, slightly more than stellar kind of black holes. And these black holes exist in X-ray binaries. And radiation from that can be used to study many of these properties. This is a very major area of study. The second one is in what is known as active galactic nuclei. Another name for this you might have heard of is quasars. So these are point-like objects in the sky. These are like stars in the sky as far as size or dimensions go. And it emits as much radiation as an entire galaxy does. So a galaxy has something like 100 billion stars. So here is an object which is so compact, but it emits so much of radiation from it. These are called active galactic nuclei, roughly speaking. I mean, I'm simplifying things a little bit. And that is powered by supermassive black holes. Black holes with the masses from a million to 10,000 times that number. So these are the two areas in which black holes came in. And you might think that these are very esoteric objects. So let me show you an animation here. What is happening here is near the center of our galaxy, our own galaxy, Milky Way, where we are part and parcel of. And at the center, there is this star-like object around which all these things are orbiting. This star-like is an artist's star. You know, he has put a hexagonal shape there. The other things are real stars. And these real stars are orbiting around an imaginary point here and going around. And this is doing it because this is a black hole. It is a black hole, and we don't see it directly. But it influence on all these stars. I mean, there are a lot more, and I just selected a set of them. Its orbital parameters allow us to figure out where it is and what is its mass and what is its properties. So it is not an esoteric object. It is very much there right near the center of our own galaxy. So that is the black hole physics. And the second thing is the expansion of the universe, which brought the entire cosmology into the gamut of physics. Now here, unfortunately, Einstein missed the boat. And as I was telling you that Einstein made a lot of mistakes, and I have been listing them. And one of the things he did was that he wrote down the equations governing the entire universe in a piece of paper, solved it, and he found that the universe is expanding. He would have just written it up as a paper, and that would have been a great movement in human civilization, not in science. If you can write down a few equations in paper and predict that the entire universe is expanding. But this guy got cold feet. So he thought that, you know, things can't be changing and it should go from everlasting to everlasting, it should be static. So he sort of tinkered with the equations and added a term to it in order to make it static. Very interestingly, he made two mistakes in adding this extra term. First is that he actually goofed on a sign. Again, simplifying things a little bit. Essentially, he thought that it is stable, but very soon people pointed out that it is not a stable solution. And even with that term, you will have expanding solutions. The second mistake is that the term which he added is what is called the cosmological constant. And today we know that it actually exists. When he found that the universe is expanding, he advocated that let us drop this term. Okay, there was a lot of ups and downs and going back and forth, but finally he said that we don't need this term. And today we find that we do need that term. So this is the interesting starting tale of cosmology. And today we are seeing the whole thing in terms of observations. The observations are leading the theory. It's almost like nuclear physics or crystallography or condensed matter or whatever. You have so much of experimental data, and you have to model each one of them painstakingly with theory. It is no longer just theoretical speculation. So I want to talk a little bit about that. So let us go back to this picture which I drew and which I told you that the radius of curvature of the universe is, or any system, when the space-time is curved, is proportional to the energy density. In the context of an expanding universe, this formula becomes very simple. It just tells you that the universe is doubling its size based on the radius of curvature. If you give me the radius of curvature and divide by the speed of light, that gives you the time. And by the time the light goes from one end to the other end of the radius of that universe, so to speak, it would have doubled in size. Now, interestingly, that means if you have a constant density, then this R curvature is constant and the doubling time is constant. It is like your NSE or whatever, you know, the money doubles in every 8th year. And that is an extraordinarily rapid growth. It is an exponential growth. So if you could keep the density constant during the expansion of the universe, which is very difficult, because as the universe expands, the density drops. So this will not apply. But if you can keep the density constant as the universe expands, universe manages to do it twice in its entire evolution, then you can have very rapid expansion. This is an important message which we will come back to. Now, what is the picture of this universe which we have from here? What we have here is that after all the observations are put together, the picture which emerges is something like this. Very early in the evolution of the universe, there were vacuum fluctuations. What we call vacuum is not an emptiness in quantum field theory. It is filled with things which are, you know, going up and down. And these vacuum fluctuations are going to produce energy density fluctuations, which grow to form the structures which we see. This is the trace of the energy density fluctuations in the universe when the universe was 1,000 times smaller. This is called cosmic microwave background radiation. So this is an actual observation. The temperature fluctuations in the sky which you see when the universe was 1,000 times smaller is produced by these vacuum fluctuations very early on. And these fluctuations in their turn grow and form the kind of structures which you see in the sky. So this is the overall picture of the universe. Starting from the vacuum, through this, you end up with these galaxies. Now, if this has to occur, and if this has to happen, you can backtrack everything from observations and ask what kind of theory will fit it. When you do that, you reach a very surprising conclusion. You find that the universe should have a very crazy composition. The normal matter of which you and I are made of, neutrons, protons, electrons, that constitutes only about 4 to 5% of all matter. Then there exists something else which is probably made of weakly interacting particles, not the standard baryonic particles, but weakly interacting particles, which is called the dark matter, that constitutes around 24 to 25%. The remaining part is not matter at all. It is that term in Einstein's equation which masquerades as matter, which Einstein introduced and threw it away, and that is called the cosmological constant. Now, this is another name for this is dark energy. I don't want to use it because, you know, it sort of makes you think in terms of Star Wars, Dark Vader, philosophy, etc. So it is none of the above. It is just a term in Einstein's equations, which Einstein introduced and then thought it is not necessary. So this is called cosmological constant, and that constitutes the remaining part of it. All these, I have just given you one example here from cosmic microwave background radiation. All this is mandated by observation. This is not some theoretical speculation where nobody wanted a universe like this, okay? But all these numbers and this composition comes directly from observation, which are not negotiable. Our task is to explain this. So the way, let me go into the details a little bit more. We think that there is normal matter in the universe. This is the density as a function of the size of the universe. It keeps falling. It's in some logarithmic scale. Now, at any given time, there is some 8 times more dark matter than normal matter. So this is the density of dark matter. In addition, there is this radiation. There is a radiation filling the entire universe. And that radiation energy density falls faster than the matter energy density because the number of photons in the universe goes down just like number of protons or neutrons. But the energy of each individual photon gets diluted because its wavelength gets increase, E equals h nu, so it decreases. So it falls faster. So if you take the total cosmic density that is given by this red line, when you go way down into the past, the radiation energy will supersede the matter energy, and there is a point at which these two energies are equal, and at that time there is a critical energy density, which I have denoted as rho eq. If this is all there is to the universe, it would have been simple. But what observations tell you is that you have to add some more. Firstly, if you want to explain the observations, very early on, this density which I have plotted like this has to turn around and remain constant. And remember, I told you that if some energy density is remaining constant, then the universe is expanding very rapidly. So that is called an inflationary phase of the universe. So at this state, the universe has to inflate like this, and it is the vacuum fluctuations in this inflationary phase which acts as the seeds for the structures which we see today. That would have been bad enough, but it turns out that there is a little bit more to come. Already you have two densities, rho eq and rho inflation, which you need to specify to describe the universe. It turns out again from direct observation, these are direct supernova observations. This tells you how the density of the universe is changing, the total density of the universe is changing as a function of the size of the universe. And as you can see, it is sort of reaching a saturation point. You can actually show that it is hitting a saturation point, and that saturation point is one more energy density. And this energy density is the energy density effectively contributed by the cosmological constant denoted by this symbol lambda, or it is the energy density due to this dark energy. So you have to add that also. So you have inflationary phase, and then there is normal matter and radiation, and then there is another cosmological constant kicks in here, and that makes it like this. So this is the three numbers which characterize the universe. Give me these three, then I can build a model for the universe. And our universe has specific values for these three numbers. and that defines for you how the cosmic energy density changes. It is constant here, and it fell from here to here. Now, if you go deeper and ask where did these numbers come from, the answer is still strange. Firstly, high energy physics, particle physics, has a hope of determining this number and this number. There are ways and models to do it. We haven't done it, but in principle it can be done. But nobody has any idea how to determine the value of the cosmological constant, which is known observationally, but we do not have a theory for that. I'll come back to this later. So far I have just described it as an object. What it is a term in Einstein's equation, which acts like a matter with negative pressure, so to speak, if you want to think. But all the matter which we know has positive pressure. So it is not really matter, but it is just a term in Einstein's equation. And it drives the accelerated expansion of the universe at the present epoch. I told you that whenever the density becomes constant, the expansion is very rapid. It is accelerating. And that is exactly what cosmological constant is doing in the current epoch, and the inflation was doing very early on. So the value of it is probably the most important puzzle which we have in theoretical physics today. Okay. So far, as I said, I was telling you the good news, what all good things came out of relativity. Now, let me ask, what are the challenges which Einstein's theory faces? So I have chosen among the problems three. One is the problem called the problem of the singularities. Second is the cosmological constant itself. And third is a very weird thermodynamic connection, which I want to talk about. So let me start with the problem of the singularities. Now, essentially what it tells you is that physics loses its predictability. So suppose I take a stone and throw it upwards, physics will be able to predict exactly where the stone would be as a function of time. Now suppose I have a neutron star and I put a colleague of mine on it, and the neutron star is going to collapse into the black hole. Every time I give this talk, I mention that you definitely will have a colleague whom you want to do this to. And everywhere people say yes, okay? So you put him on this neutron star and it collapses to form a black hole. And the colleague asks you, okay, that is fine, I'm willing to sit there. But what is going to happen to me when my clock shows, say, 3:30, 3:45, 4, 4:30, etc.? You tell me what is going to happen to me. Then you do your calculation. Then you have to tell him that, no, I cannot tell you. I can tell you up to 3:27 what will happen. At 3:27, my calculations stop. I do not know what is going to happen to you after 3:27. Now, this actually happens. We do not know how to predict what happens to the end stages of a collapsing black hole. We do not know what happened at the very early stages of the universe's, what we call the Big Bang. So physics loses its predictability. And this is essentially because there is a quantity with the dimensions of area you can construct with G, H cross, and C, gravity, quantum theory, and relativity. And this number, when the sizes of the objects are of this order, this is a very tiny number, then the laws of physics has to change. The quantum gravitational effects has to be taken into account. The second problem is the problem of the cosmological constant. We said that gravity is a very beautiful theory, very symmetric theory and all that, but it breaks a symmetry known to us. We all teach students that if you are measuring voltage, what we measure is the potential difference. The absolute value of the energy doesn't matter. If you are doing some hydrogen atom problem, the absolute value of the Hamiltonian doesn't matter. You keep changing the zero value, nothing will change. But in gravity, that is not the case. Gravity couples to the absolute value in Einstein's theory. But practically, when you look at it, it turns out that in the current observations, it doesn't really seem to couple. So there is a contradiction between what theory naively tells you and what observations tell you. Now, this is related to the fact that there are these three constants from physics, and then I said there is something called cosmological constant. So if you take the cosmological constant and these three constants, together you can form a dimensionless number. Because this has dimensions of length square, this has dimensions of 1 by length square, because the curvature square, energy density. and you multiply these two together, you get a pure number. And this number is extraordinarily tiny. It is 10 to the power minus 123. The question is, why is this number so tiny? When such a tiny number, you would have thought should be zero. But it is not zero. We can measure it, and we know that it is not zero, and we know that its value is so tiny. Of course, nobody measures this number directly. You indirectly measure other numbers and then figure out what that number is, and it is an extraordinarily tiny number. Now, the third result, which is going to form the central theme when I am going to talk about the concluding part of this lecture, there is a very beautiful result which comes up when you put quantum theory and gravity together. We have not done it with its full glory, but even when you put these principles together at some level, you get a very beautiful result. And the result is that certain class of observers who cannot see the whole of space-time, it is like you stand at a seashore and you can see the horizon. You cannot see Saudi Arabia if you are on the western coast, because there is a horizon due to the curvature of the earth. In the same way, there is a horizon which comes because of the curvature of space-time. And if there is a horizon and you cannot see beyond the horizon, such observers see a temperature. They attribute a temperature to the space-time. So black hole is a classic example. Everybody knows that black hole has a temperature. Black hole has a temperature because the guy who is sitting outside the black hole, he cannot see inside the black hole. No, nothing escapes from inside to him, and he attributes a temperature to the black hole. Now, if you find it puzzling, think in terms of entropy in thermodynamics. Entropy arises because certain degrees of freedom are not observed, or you integrate it out. And if there are some region which you cannot observe, there are degrees of freedom which you cannot observe, as a result of which you end up with an entropy and a temperature to that system. So the space-time itself has a heat density. At this point in space here, I can attribute a heat density. Just as if I have a glass of water, I can attribute a temperature and entropy density to that glass of water. So the thermodynamics plays a very crucial role in the description of the space-time. So more precisely, if you take some event in space-time and you have an observer who is freely falling, this is like the Galileo's balls which has been dropped and it is falling freely, he does not experience any gravity. And he will have a vacuum fluctuations here. I told you that the vacuum is something which is bristling with activity. And a guy who is sitting quietly at the same point, not falling freely, like any of us who are sitting in a chair, compared to a guy who is falling freely through that point, he will see these vacuum fluctuations as thermal fluctuations. He will associate a temperature with it. And we don't quite understand why space-time exhibits such thermal properties. What we do know is that when you look at all these problems, it has a H cross in it and a G in it in some form. So you have to put together the principles of gravity and quantum theory together. So you have to quantize gravity. So in my institute, there is this saying that everybody wants to quantize gravity, because every student who joins the institute says, what do you want to do? I want to quantize gravity. I want to work with so-and-so. Okay, so we used to think it is a joke, but it is really true. I came to know of it very recently. Anne Hathaway, the Hollywood actress, one of my favorite actresses, and she says she is spending all her spare time learning string theory and about universe and black holes and space-time and stuff like that. So she wants to understand quantum mechanics and gravity comes together. So everybody really wants to quantize gravity. But nobody has succeeded. Okay? It's definitely not due to lack of manpower or person power. People are putting tremendous effort. And the question is why? The reason is purely technical. The standard way in which you approach quantum field theory is what is known as a perturbative approach. You keep calculating corrections order by order. And this method just doesn't work in gravity. And there is no real guiding principle. As a result of which, we have not succeeded. But the next 100 years, this is going to be the major event. And the prediction from me is that gravity is going to require yet another paradigm shift. Originally, we thought gravity was a force. Einstein came along and said gravity is the curvature of space-time. That is the idea which we have till today. But what the recent work suggests is that gravity could be what we call an emergent phenomenon. So I want to spend a little bit of time trying to tell you what is an emergent phenomenon. So this is a big word, but it is actually something which all of us are familiar with, and many of you work on this much more than I do. The elasticity, if you are making something in BARC where there is some iron beams are put like this auditorium, and you want these things to bend and it wants to withhold things and it has to sustain some amount of strength, etc., you want to know the elastic properties of that material. No good engineer at that time will ask you, give me the equation defining the neutron. He will tell you what are the equations of elasticity. And there are elementary things like Young's modulus or strength constants, etc. You use them and you can study elasticity. Same thing with gas dynamics. If you look at an ideal gas, you can write down an equation PV equals RT. You don't have to worry whether it is made of neons, argon, helium, hydrogen. As long as the ideal gas assumption holds, this equation is true. So emergent phenomena like gas dynamics or elasticity are the ones which has a life of its own. It has a set of equations describing it, but it is not a fundamental description. The bending of a beam involves bending of zillions of atoms along the beam. And you don't worry about the atoms, you just talk about the bending of the beam. Similarly, when you are talking about PV equals RT, there are molecules, some 10 to the 24 of these molecules moving all over the place, and that is what is giving you the pressure. But you don't have to worry about it. So in the same way, the dynamics is completely reasonably independent of this microstructure. We believe that Einstein's theory can also be described by this. How can we do that? Here we take a ride on the shoulder of a great man, Boltzmann, who is an Austrian physicist, who told you something very important. Stated very simply, he said that if you can heat it, it must have microstructure. Before Boltzmann, people did not know what was heat. And the history at that time is very interesting. People thought that if you take hot water and mix it with cold water, the hot water has something called a calorific fluid which passes from there to this. But then this fluid should have very weird properties. It should not have weight because hot water and cold water weighs the same. It should have various other peculiar properties. And all these things tied themselves up in knots in order to understand the phenomena of heat. Boltzmann came along and said, all this is nonsense. Matter exhibits thermal phenomena because matter is not a continuum. Water is not a continuum. It is made of discrete molecules with empty space in between. And because it is made of discrete particles or degrees of freedom, it could contain energy. So if you can heat something, you can dump energy into it, and it should be able to hold that energy, it should have microstructure. Now we know that this microscopic degrees of freedom are needed if something exhibits thermal phenomena. But I just saw that gravity is intimately connected with thermal phenomena. Space-times have temperature. So if space-times have temperature, then the Boltzmann's paradigm tells you that the space-time should have microscopic degrees of freedom. Just as water has atoms of water, space-time should have atoms of space moving around. Now, this is an extraordinary concept. It is not easy to understand because even in the case of water, when first Boltzmann said that water is made of discrete molecules, people just foo-fooed it because they said, how can it be? I mean, we can move my hand through water and it looks very continuous. I mean, nobody has seen these atoms. But fortunately, we could see it immediately after some time. But now we are very far away technologically from seeing the atoms of space-time. But you can use exactly the same kind of a theory. Quantitatively, Boltzmann also told us that if you want to store an energy delta E, how many degrees of freedom you need? This is something which we teach everybody, E is equal to half NKT. But it should be written more like this. The amount of energy is delta E, and if you want to store it at a temperature T, then you better have this many degrees of freedom. Now, in the case of gravity, you can again heat up space-time and cool down space-time. So you can actually count how many degrees of freedom or how many atoms of space-time exist in space? This is something which we have done. We do not know what the atoms of space are, but we know how many of them are there. If you take a small stamp, 1 square centimeter in size, it has 10 to the power 66 atoms of space. It is a lot more than the normal atoms that stamp is made of. That many atoms of space exist per unit area, and you can count that, and you can write down a distribution function for that. Just as you say how many atoms are there in water at some particular point with various attributes like the spin or momentum, etc., you can write down a distribution function for the atoms of space. And you can study the entire theory of gravity from it, and it turns out that gravity is almost indistinguishable from thermodynamics or kinetic theory, any of the emergent phenomena which we know of. This has been the major progress in the last 10 years. The reason it is very difficult to test it in laboratory systems is because when we study the atomic structure of water or any other material, you are talking about tens of angstroms, and that is accessible to experiment. You can actually see it in an electron microscope. But in for gravity, the corresponding length scale is enormously tiny. It is like 10 to the minus 33 centimeter. Just to show you how tiny it is, I have a cartoon here. This is what I would call the macro scales, and this is what I call the micro scales. I am going in powers of 10. So when I go in 10 powers of 10, I get sun. This is solar system here. This is a galaxy. This is a cluster of galaxy. And this is the farthest point in the sky from which we get direct electromagnetic signal. This is the cosmic microwave background radiation. This is the sort of edge of the visible universe. That is 30 powers of 10 from everyday scales. Now let us go into the microscopic scales. Here is your atom. Here is your nucleus. This is the edge of laboratory physics. This is LHC. The electroweak unification and LHC operates at this scale. So we have only gone this much compared to what we have achieved in astronomy and astrophysics. You go up to this, and then there are theoretical speculations which can take you up to this point. This is grand unified theory schemes. The edge of the universe, this 30 orders of 30 powers of 10 you went here. If you go here, you get this point. The physics I am talking about is still outside. Okay? So it is enormously tiny, so you cannot detect it directly in the laboratory. But then what do you do? Physics is a predictive theory. I mean, if you cannot make predictions, if you cannot give numbers, you are not doing physics. You are doing philosophy or mathematics. So you have to come out with predictions which you can make. The solution lies in cosmology. Because this tiny length scale is beaten by the vastness of the cosmos. In cosmic expanse, if you apply all these laws which I told you, like the thermodynamic interpretation of gravity, etc., it turns out that the expansion of a region of space, the universe is supposed to expand, the expansion of a region of space is decided by two objects. One is the number of degrees of freedom on the surface contributed by the atoms of space-time. And the second is the number of normal atoms, the normal matter, which is contributing in the bulk. So there is number of degrees of freedom in the surface, number of degrees of freedom in the bulk. And the equation describing the expansion of the universe is extremely simple. This is the size of the universe. dr by dt, the rate at which it is changing, is given by 1 minus this ratio. So when this is equal to this, it stops expanding. It doesn't change in its size. Stop expanding in the sense that the densities and the dynamic size doesn't change. The universe actually expands in an accelerated way. The dynamic size called the Hubble radius doesn't change. So this equation where the n bulk and n surface are equal to each other is some kind of an equipartition or an equilibrium. And when they are not the same, then the densities in the universe and the Hubble radius, which is the effective size of the universe, changes. So I told you that coming back to this picture, the universe had one phase where it was constant, here it was constant, and here it changed with time. In the approach which I am describing, it turns out that at this place, n surface is equal to n bulk, here n surface is equal to n bulk. It is like two equilibrium situations. It also turns out when you work things out that this is an unstable equilibrium and this is a stable equilibrium. And the universe is making a transition between this to this. So it is thermodynamics all the way through. The standard concept of thermodynamics and statistical mechanics which you have learned applies to the entire universe in terms of the atoms of space and time. When you do that, you find that in between this n surface is not equal to n bulk, and that is why it is changing. And there is a principle which you cannot have in Einstein's theory, but when you combine this paradigm with Einstein's equation, there is an extra principle which allows you to connect this phase with this phase. As a result of it, these three densities, which are completely arbitrary and was only determined by observation, get linked together. And you can write down an equation connecting these three densities. So here is that equation. The cosmological constant, which is extraordinarily tiny and whose value we want to determine, can be written in terms of the other two quantities which can be determined from high energy physics. So this is the elementary formula which comes out of this theory. And the reason it is very tiny is because of this factor. It is an exponential minus 36 pi square. It is pure constants. And what you will see is that there are no free parameters in this theory. I have just three densities, and all the three densities can be observationally determined. So I can go and check whether this theory is true. Now, in today's world, we know this and this very well from cosmology, but unfortunately, we don't actually know the inflationary scale. So what we can do is that we can predict what that inflationary scale is. And it is in some units called GeV. It has to be between some 1.08 and 1.24. Now, if you take all the uncertainties into the account, this can change by a factor 5. So this theory makes a very clear prediction. It tells you that this scale, which we don't know from observations directly yet, is a number which I can predict. And this is something which can be tested in the next 10 years. And we already believe that this number is very close to what I have been saying. So there is a very strong hope that this relation will be observationally verified. So the fact that when you put quantum theory and gravity together and change the paradigm and talk about gravity in the thermodynamic language is not empty philosophy. It finally leads to observable consequences and a falsifiable prediction. You can go test it in the sky, and if this equation doesn't hold, then the theory is wrong. Okay? So this is something which we found to be very pleasing. So let me just sum up what I have been saying so far. The first point is that we do understand the evolution of the universe from a fraction of a second to 14 billion years. We have a huge amount of observational results thanks to general theory of relativity, because general theory of relativity is what started this game. And we now know how to describe the universe very well. We have a picture that the vacuum fluctuations at the very early universe, which involved an inflationary phase of expansion of the universe, generated the seeds from which all the structure which we see, all the galaxies, all the clusters of galaxies, planetary systems, you and me, everything came out of that vacuum fluctuation. There is the composition of the universe, which is made of normal matter, dark matter, and cosmological constant, acting as some kind of a dark energy. And the cosmological constant contributes nearly 70 to 72% of the energy density of the universe today. And this is what is accelerating the expansion of the universe. So a deep mystery is to understand the numerical value of this cosmological constant. We believe that it can be done, but in order to do that, we have to turn things upside down again. We need yet another paradigm shift. And in that new paradigm, when you think of gravity as a thermodynamic phenomena or an emergent phenomena, we have hopes of understanding this particular entity. Thank you very much.
The large magnetic field.
Right.
Objects.
Yeah.
And these are called magnetic stars. They're calling it as magnetars.
Right.
Now, how do these, can you please highlight how do these magnetars affect your gravitation?
No, they have no direct relevance to what I have been talking about, because the scales at which magnetars operate, these magnetars have extraordinarily high magnetic field, which came as a surprise. We don't completely theoretically understand that. But the sizes and the gravitational forces exerted by these magnetars are very tiny in the cosmic scale. Because this is at the stellar system scale, and then you have galaxies, which is 100 billion of such stars. And then there are thousands of galaxies forming up a cluster, and I'm talking about a large number of cluster scales. So at the scales at which I am operating, these phenomena do not affect anything.
That conventionally we are accustomed to see GTR in terms of energy momentum tensors right. And all. Now when you are passing to the cosmology, like energy momentum tensor endowed with the cosmological constant
right.
And then the, so now with this introduction of quantum picture, like mm-hmm. quantization, will it have implication on the current form of energy momentum relation?
Oh yes, very much. Sorry, you're finished?
Yeah.
This is what it is. Yeah. Okay. So first of all, the cosmological constant has its own energy momentum tensor. The way it works is that normally when you write Einstein's equation, there is a geometrical term on the left-hand side and an energy momentum tensor on the right-hand side. Now, Einstein changed the left-hand side with a cosmological constant, but I can just move it to the right-hand side. So there is an effective effective energy momentum tensor which I can associate with the cosmological constant. In fact, it is proportional to Kronecker delta. It's a 4x4 matrix. Diagonal entries are 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay. So it is a very simple energy momentum tensor. Now, when you study this inflationary phase and you say that the vacuum fluctuations have generated all these perturbations which we see in the sky, we are actually computing the energy momentum tensor of these vacuum fluctuations. And you have to actually take that into account, calculate things, only then it matches with predictions. And this is now, these are all directly accessible to observations today, because we do see the universe when it was 1,000 times smaller in the form of cosmic microwave background radiation. So that is certainly taken into account. But it is a tougher problem to ask what is the energy momentum tensor of gravity itself, and how the gravitational energy, or whatever you call gravitational energy, gets modified when the quantum gravitational picture comes in. That we do not know.
That energy momentum tensor, which is encompassing at present like baryonic matter and radiation fields,
right,
will have another component because of this.
Because of the cosmological constant. That's correct.
Has to be still added and to be.
Yeah. So adding the cosmological constant is straightforward.
Okay.
Because that comes in at the classical level itself, and you know exactly how to add that.
Yeah.
It is just like any other matter. It's just a mathematics as to whether you want to keep it on the left-hand side or you want to keep it on the right-hand side. Keep it on the left-hand side, you will call it geometry. You keep it on the right-hand side, you will say it is an effective energy momentum tensor. But taking into account the quantum vacuum fluctuations and adding its energy momentum tensor is a little trickier.
Okay. So thank you, sir, for your answer.
I wanted to ask that whatever the constant you are using, for example, Planck constant,
right,
whether it is universal through all the universe or not.
Okay. So we only have answer based on observations, right? Because theoretically there is no model which tells you that Planck constant, for example, should vary with space and time, and that it is different here compared to different here. But observationally, when you see hydrogen spectra of a star or a quasar from this side, and you look at the hydrogen spectra from somewhere here, or even any element known to humanity, they are identical. So in the hydrogen spectra, when you write down the energy levels, you have things like H cross going in. And if it was different here and there, then you will see a difference. We don't see that. So the hypothesis is that it is the same everywhere seems to be vindicated.
Thank you.
Sir, you said that the cosmological constant also need a paradigm shift in understanding the value. Why it is so
sorry,
small?
Cosmological constant
the value of the cosmological constant
right.
has a very small value.
Right.
So, you to understand that, why its value is so small,
right.
we need another paradigm shift.
That's correct.
So, how far multiverse concept explains this small value?
Right.
So is it first, explained correctly or?
First of all, multiverse doesn't explain this at all. What multiverse does is that the value of the cosmological constant can be different in different universes. So it can be anything. It can be 10. It can be 10 to the power 100. It can be 10 to the power minus 100. And there are various universes with various values. It just so happens that we are in a universe where the value is 10 to the minus 122. So that is not an explanation. It just says that it has different values. And then you have to invoke something like anthropic principles to say why we are here. But even if you do all that, which I think is highly objectionable, even if you do all that, you finally don't get the number. See, the model which I have explained to you based on my work, it actually gives you the answer to a couple of decimal places. So it is not like saying that in a multiverse, if you use anthropic principle, if the cosmological constant was, let us say, 1/10 of the current value, or 5 times the current value, nothing will go wrong. So you cannot really predict it from any of these ideas. So the only prediction for the numerical value of cosmological constant, as far as I know, and in fact, this we have discussed in several forums, is from the model which I have presented here.
Sir, you have shown space-time as a discrete. Does it mean time is also discrete?
No. It turns out that when you actually work this whole thing out, it is more like you have atoms of space rather than atoms of space-time. And the atoms of space do evolve in time. Time is not discrete in this model. The answer is a little bit more technical than that. This is a very simplified answer. It has something called Euclidean space and a Lorentzian space. Are you aware of this? No, okay. So it is essentially, it has to do with when you take normally space and distance between two points, you say dx square plus dy square plus dz square. But if you do it in space time, you will say dx square plus dy square plus dz square minus c square dt square. So there is a minus sign. So if you put a minus sign, it is called a Lorentzian space. If you put all plus, it is called a Euclidean space. Now, depending on whether you are developing your theory in a Euclidean sector or in the Lorentzian sector, you can take a point of view that time is also discrete or time is not discrete. And it turns out you can translate between these two and nothing will go wrong. So it is just a question of mathematical convenience. So what is really the message you should take home is that the space is discrete. Whether time is discrete or not depends on the point of view you take, and it doesn't make any difference.
Is there the concept of entropy in your atoms of space-time, and is there irreversibility the way we see in normal thermodynamics?
Okay, there is definitely the concept of entropy in the form of atoms of space-time, and what you actually do is that you take space-time and you attribute to it unknown degrees of freedom, and then these degrees of freedom, when you average over, that gives you certain amount of entropy. It's just like in kinetic theory, it is F log F. Okay, you can write down the expression for this entropy, and then you can do one more thing. You can take this entropy, add to it the entropy of matter, and maximize it. What you get is Einstein's equations. So what we have thought of as Einstein's field equation is just a thermodynamic equation arising from maximizing the entropy of space-time plus the entropy of matter.
And there is irreversibility, evolution?
Right. Now, the irreversibility which we normally attribute to entropy in standard theory is a statistical irreversibility, right? Yes. Because you know that there is always a probability equations that all the molecules will go to one corner of a box. Yeah. It is just that the probability is very low. Yes. So it turns out that you cannot translate that attribute to the gravitational theories directly. So there is no natural notion of microscopic irreversibility. The theory which you get is actually time reversal invariant. So there is no intrinsic irreversibility or the arrow of time or any of those things. Okay. Doesn't come from this. We looked hard for that. It would have been nice if it comes, but it doesn't come.
Hello. So sir, in Hubble's law, at some particular value of R, we will be equal to C.
That's right.
So what is your comment on that scenario?
In fact, at some particular value, we will be some 30 times C. And we see objects I mean, we observe objects which, if you do this kind of a calculation, will have a velocity which is much greater than that of light. Yes. But there is absolutely no problem with it. Because it is usually people say that Einstein's theory tells you that nothing can travel faster than light. Einstein's theory doesn't say any such thing. What Einstein's theory tells you is that you cannot send signals at a speed faster than that of light. Yeah, so there is no signal propagation here.
Yeah, so my point is that will set a kind of cosmological horizon. Beyond that, we cannot see the universe. So
actually, you are almost right in the sense that there is a cosmological horizon in some space-time, and beyond that, you cannot see. But it has nothing to do with the speed of light being a limiting factor.
Yes, sir. Okay, thank you.
Sir, actually, I've just read through some magazines that Big Bang theory, Big Bang is started at some 10 to the power 14 billion years ago.
Right.
But they, at the same time, they say that when we observe, in all the directions, we are able to observe 14 billion years away. But we know that we are not in the center of the universe. Then how we can say that all around it will be 14 billion? We are not able to observe more than that. Even Big Bang might have happened before that also.
Yeah. So actually, Big Bang didn't happen like a Diwali cracker explosion at some point. The Big Bang is when the space and time itself got created. So it happened everywhere. So the right way to think about this is to imagine that you are on the surface of a balloon. Suppose you are on the surface of a balloon and you take one point as the North Pole. And then you go along some particular direction. And you see everything around you in a particular way. Now somebody else is at some other point, because any point on the surface of a balloon can be thought of as North Pole. I can just rotate it around. So at some other point, he also sees the same phenomenon. So every observer in the universe will think that he is at the center of the universe. But there is no real center. Just like on the surface of a sphere, there is no center. I'm not talking about the center of the sphere. You take a spherical balloon, think of the surface as your world, that two-dimensional surface as your world. That does not have a center. Any point can be thought of as North Pole. You can draw latitudinal circles around any point, and those circles will look as though up to the equator, it will keep expanding, and you will think that that is sort of a center. But I could have done it with any point. That is what happens in the universe.
Thanks.
So if there are no more questions, let us thank Professor Padmanabhan for an illuminating talk. And as a token of our appreciation, I would request Sri S. Bharadwaj to offer a memento to Professor Padmanabhan. Thank you very much.